Big fluff.
Is she going to be okay?
Jean Grey is the only Class 5 mutant I've ever encountered, her potential practically limitless. Her mutation is seated in the unconscious part of her mind, and therein lay the danger. When she was a girl, I created a series of psychic barriers to isolate her powers from her conscious mind. And as a result, Jean developed a dual personality.
What?
The conscious Jean, whose powers were always in her control, and the dormant side. A personality that in our sessions came to call itself the Phoenix. A purely instinctual creature, all desire and joy and rage.
Hey everybody, I'm Joel Murphy.
And I'm Andy McIntyre.
And this is Silver Linings Playback, the podcast where we watch maligned movies and we find their silver linings.
And it is July, which means that Deadpool and Wolverine is coming out, and there are a lot of bad movies with the X-Men, so we're watching them.
Nailed it. That's right. That movie's coming out, and there's a lot of bad movies with these characters in them. Boom.
I mean, keep it simple, right?
Although, I imagine that some of our fictional straw man listeners that I just made up for this point that I'm about to make are confused, and they're thinking, but why'd you start with this one? It's The Last Stand. So this must have been the last X-Men movie they ever made. Why didn't you go back further? No. They were faking us. The Last Stand was not The Last Stand. It was just the beginning of the journey that we're on.
Yeah, it was the third one, which was the original title, X-Men, the third one. And they're like, now we need something punchier.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, let's talk about these movies, because I don't know about you, but I actually did my homework, and I decided, since we were doing this month, I didn't just watch The Last Stand. I watched X-Men. I watched X2, and then I watched X-Men, The Last
Stand. Wait, X2, X-Men United?
Yes, X2. It is weird, by the way, that there's a movie called X, a movie called X2, and a movie called Triple X, and they are completely unrelated to each other. Just want to put
and
that
there's also
there.
Ballistic X versus Sever, also sure. Unrelated.
Sure, but I mean, I'm just saying, like, X2 Triple X sounds like
they would be in a series. Yes.
Yeah. But no, they're, one of them is a horror movie about people shooting a porn and being murdered. The second one is, you know, the X-Men movie. And then the third one is whatever that was with Vin Diesel or whatever.
Yeah. It was a dumb action movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With Vin Diesel. Shocking. I know that he did a dumb action movie.
Weirdly, X, the only one we couldn't do on this podcast because it's too good.
Yeah. Well, X2 has a, I like X2.
Oh, actually, no, X, yeah, never mind. X2 is the best. It's, like, would you agree with that? That's probably the bar.
For X-Men movies?
Of this franchise. That was the high point.
I like Days of Future Past a lot, too. Mm-hmm. But yeah, probably X2.
Yeah.
No, I think there are 4 good X movies and 5 bad ones. And we're going to watch the 5 bad ones this month.
What are the 4 good ones? We said 2 of them.
I would say X2, Days of Future Past, First Class is enjoyable, and then the original X-Men is fun.
Yeah. Although, did you, and it's fine if you didn't, no one needs to, but did you go back and watch the other ones?
I rewatched both of them, because I saw that you'd posted on your Letterboxd that you'd watched X-Men. So like, oh, Joel must be watching, doing his homework. So I was like, I'm going to do it too.
Yeah. Like, because I agree, X2, delightful watch. I like that movie. There's of course little things that I might.
Oh yeah. None of them are perfect movies by any stretch,
but X-Men, the first one, is clunkier than I thought, than I remembered.
It doesn't seem sure of itself. Like, it doesn't exactly, because I was fairly recent in the second run of superhero movies, like the most recent renaissance, I guess. Because it was, you know, Spider-Man had come out, but that was about it, I think, at that point.
Of the good, yeah, I think
of
so.
Like the 2000s, like renaissance of superhero movies.
I think the first X-Men might predate the first Spider-Man, but
oh, you might actually you might be right.
Yeah, but they were contemporary either way.
Yeah, it was still very early, and it was when they finally had the special effects technology to make superhero movies not cheesy by design almost.
I will say, and I'll give the caveat that watching Infinity War in a movie theater with a packed house is one of my favorite movie memories of all time, and it was truly wonderful. But I don't think for the superhero genre, anything has hit me as hard or will ever hit me as hard as the first time I saw Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man swing through New York, and it looked good.
Yeah, Tobey Maguire's Spider-Maning in the first Spider-Man was, because it was as much of the comic books come to life as had yet happened on the big screen, I would say.
Yeah, no, I still think that is my high mark for all superhero movies. I'm still chasing that high.
Chasing that dragon.
Yeah, decades later, I'm like, I just want to feel like I did.
When Tobey Maguire thwipped through the city.
I will say, you can tell, by the way, by a full 2 years, the first X-Men came out in 2000 and the first Spider-Man came out in 2002.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But they were obviously, like we said, coming out around the same time, because this is later than that Spider-Man. But you can see that in the first one that there's a lot of this sort of idea that, well, who are you? I'm Storm. And then it's like, what a ridiculous name. Like they don't just accept. And I think that's a thing that when Marvel really went full tilt, that they just went with of like, no, this guy's Captain America, this guy's Iron Man, like just whatever. Don't question it. But you can see a lot of that of like, they call you Wolverine. Okay, you know,
yeah, like they weren't sure how much to trust their viewers.
Which also, this is the last thing I'll say about that movie, because we're not here to discuss it, but it's relevant but not important. But you know what joke I hate in that movie is when
the yellow spandex one.
That's exactly what I was gonna say. Friend of the show, James Marsden, says to Wolverine, Wolverine's complaining about their outfits, and he says, well, would you prefer yellow spandex? We get that because we read the comics. What does that mean to Hugh Jackman's Wolverine, though?
Yeah, what a bizarre non sequitur.
Like, you want him to be like, what the fuck are you talking about?
I just want him to be deadpan. It's like, yes, I want to wear yellow spandex.
And look, we're here this month because it took 20 years, but Hugh Jackman's finally wearing yellow spandex.
It pays off that joke finally.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope, man, it's too late now to add this, but how wonderful would it have been if there's a moment where Deadpool and Wolverine are in a Quinjet and Wolverine's complaining about his yellow spandex costume, and Deadpool just looks at him and goes, what would you prefer, a black jumpsuit?
A black leather jumpsuit.
That would actually make me very happy.
I'll say it. You know, this is gonna air before, this is gonna go live before the movie comes out. So we may be geniuses.
We might be. Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah. I wouldn't put that. That's I don't. I think that's a fairly safe bet.
Yeah, I hope it happens.
I do too.
But yeah, so the first one, it's hit or miss. The worst line outside of the yellow spandex is, in much disgust, is the what happens to a toad when it's struck by lightning, which is, fittingly written by Joss Whedon, who was offered X3 and turned it down to make a Wonder Woman movie that was never made.
Yep.
But then, yeah, we got X2, which is great. It's very good.
X2 is awesome. Like, yeah. The action still holds up 15 odd years later. Alan Cumming is great as Nightcrawler. Like, it's a cool flick. Brian Cox is great. Like, it's a great movie. I love it.
Yep. And then we got two of those from Bryan Singer. He left to go make a Superman movie,
which is awful.
Which is awful. And had made it with Kevin Spacey. So it was also an awful set all around.
With both Bryan Singer and Kevin Spacey there. Yeah.
Yeah. And
good thing that his replacement didn't create a hostile work environment on it. Oh, wait, no.
Yeah. Well, we can talk about, but there was a brief time that we can, before we dive into this movie, we can all close our eyes and imagine what could have been, where Matthew Vaughn almost directed this movie.
Would have been better.
Yeah. And I guess I'll just put this here because this was actually a fairly recent revelation comparative to when we're recording this. He apparently was like recently talking about it and said that he quit the movie because he was in a meeting with someone from Fox and he saw a script sitting on the guy's desk that looked thicker than the shooting script. And he was confused and he was like, what is this? Guy says, don't worry about it. So he picks it up, starts looking through it. The first scene is Storm saving kids in Africa. And he's like, what is this? And the guy says, oh, well, Halle Berry hasn't signed on yet. So we wrote a fake script to get her to be a part of it. And then we're just going to cut all these scenes once she signs on. And then he was like, nope, I'm out.
And he was right.
He was right. But how insane is that story? Like,
That's banana. I mean, unsurprising, but bananas.
But yeah, apparently there was also the before he said that specific thing, the line was always that, well, I think his official before finally throwing that guy under the bus was that, or, you know, not under the bus, but you know what I mean? Finally, to sharing that story because enough time had passed that he had always said that he wanted to do it, but they, because the execs were mad about the Superman thing, they wanted to beat Superman to the movie theaters. So they had a super rushed production. And he said, I can't do this in this timeline and make it good.
No. And you can feel how rushed and half baked everything in this movie is.
Yes. And apparently he did do there. Like, obviously was a draft of the script that he did. And I think a little thing survived here and there. Apparently the scene with is it Archangel? Is that the name of the character? The one with the wings?
Angel,
before
he becomes Archangel, yeah.
Right. But apparently that scene from the beginning where he's shaving his wings off, that was in the original script that Vaughn's team submitted. He passed and we got Brett Ratner, the infamous.
The one and only, thank goodness, Brett Ratner.
And no, this movie's dumb and bad. It should have been great because who doesn't love the Dark Phoenix saga?
Which they've nailed every time they tried to put it on the big screen.
Look, hear me out. They should do it one more time and I'll tell you why.
They should take one more stab at it.
It took them three times to do a good Wolverine movie. So apparently the third time is the charm.
With X-Men movies, you might be right.
Yeah. They got to keep swinging. And then eventually they'll hit like, okay, well, there we go.
All right. Okay, we got it.
So,
stay tuned later this month when we watch X-Men Dark Phoenix, which is probably the worst one in this franchise, which is saying something.
I'm excited. I never watched it. So
good.
We can get my fresh take on it. So we ended up with this movie, which is supposedly the Phoenix saga, but it's weird. It's not,
but it's
really
combined with the Mutant Cure saga and other stuff. Like, it's
yeah. And we do get an explanation for the Phoenix, but it's, I mean, look, I'll in defense of this movie, and this is the only defense I'll give it, is that it's hard to find a way into the story as much as it's a beloved comic book story because it's about aliens. It's about the X-Men going to space and a space alien, you know, sort of taking over Jean Grey.
No, the superhero cinema world didn't have enough goodwill to do a note for note Dark Phoenix saga.
Well, it literally is Endgame.
Or even a Phoenix saga.
Right. But yeah, it's like even the current Marvel, the MCU waited until Endgame to really put a bunch of normal Earth-bound heroes into space and then kind of made it into a, like, who here has been to space? But they really slow played doing that.
Yeah, no, they built up a lot of goodwill. They built up a lot of just like the audience was in for the ride. There was no way after how, for lack of a better word, grounded X-Men and X2 were relative to superhero movies. Like, it would have been a big leap to see that Professor X is dating this bird woman from outer space, and an alien force that looks like a bird takes over Jean Grey's body, and then, you know, she comes down to Earth and they have to get rid of the alien force, and then the alien force turns evil, and then they have to kill her, and then a clone comes back and Scott has sex with the clone. Because that's what happens. That's the Phoenix Saga.
Right. Yeah. And it's...
And that's a leap.
It's a big ask. It is, for sure.
It's a leap. No, so I think that their attempt to sort of retcon it as an alternate, like, dissociative identity for Jean Grey, that works.
It does, but it doesn't. So, like
yeah.
It does in that it's a simple explanation to get where you want to go, but I think the problem with it is... Then she starts murdering people, and you've now created a world where you're saying that the murders that happen are the result of Jean Grey, a personality that she has, and Charles Xavier, essentially, and what he did to her brain.
Right. Like, making him the villain didn't make a lot of sense.
No. And yeah, I think, like, I don't know if you could have gotten there, maybe, because it's worth remembering, and obviously that movie we've done on the show, it didn't work out super well, but, you know, Spider-Man 3 got, you know, an alien symbiote to come to Earth and be Venom, so maybe you could have not had them go to space, but could have had a space alien entity, maybe you don't even have to say space, just a thing possesses Jean Grey that's not her.
Yeah, it could have been, you know, the spirit of Earth or something like that. And it's the Phoenix, or,
I mean, it's as simple as, like, we saw her drown. You know, she was underwater at the end of the other one.
And Jean, there's like the Phoenix silhouette on the water. And
just be like, Jean came back, but there was something down there with her. You could have said that. We don't need to know what it is.
Yeah, we if the movie's good enough, we won't ask that. Well, we'll ask those questions, but the average audience member will not.
And also, I mean, like, you live in Baltimore. I used to live in Baltimore. If someone went into the harbor there and then you were like, something came back with them, you'd be like, that sounds right.
Yeah, that's now they can just kill people with a single thought. Probably.
That seems right, because you shouldn't swim in that water.
They're if people on fire. Don't know,
Yeah, totally tracks. 100% tracks. Maybe that's where all mutants come from, is like at some point they all swam in the Baltimore Harbor.
Took a dip in the harbor.
The worst thing I've ever seen is when they did a Red Bull Flugtag event in Baltimore, and I went to it, and every single, so they make these little like gliders, and it's about how far they go, but every single person ends up in the harbor and then has to swim back to the shore. And it horrified me to watch. All from out of town. They don't know better.
73 casualties that day.
I mean, that was a long enough ago that we could follow up with them and see.
And see who's doing all right.
Yeah.
None of them.
Yeah.
It's a Hulu documentary waiting to happen.
That's our new podcast spinoff. We're going to do a serial style spinoff where we track down everyone who was in the water that day.
On everyone that was in the 2011 Flugtag.
I think it was something like that. I don't remember what year, but that was about right.
I just took a guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
But no, anyway, so Dark Phoenix, and they also could have made Dark Phoenix the centerpiece story.
Well, right. I don't know why you're also doing Mutants Can Be Healed, which seems like a separate storyline that could have been everything. Because it's weird. That's a thing from the comics and from the X-Men cartoon of obviously it's very understandable that Rogue would want to be healed if that was offered, or at least consider it and get close enough that she's about to do it. But that kind of doesn't really get the time to breathe either, because there's so much happening in this movie.
Because I think there's enough story with Jean being possessed by the Phoenix Force, and, you know, various entities vying for control of her and the Phoenix Force, and that being the central conflict. And, you know, you could do the Hellfire Club, or you could just do Magneto and the Brotherhood, and, you know, you don't have to introduce a host of new characters. But there was the version that was talked about where they're like, Sigourney Weaver's going to play Emma Frost and all this is going to happen. I was like, that was never going to be a thing.
That was the Vaughn pitch, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which, yeah, who knows? I think, wasn't there, it was like Keanu Reeves he wanted in it too, right?
As Gambit.
Yeah. which I love Keanu Reeves, but don't, but he can't do the accent. Don't ask
him. Never make accent. Keanu Reeves do an accent ever.
No.
At some point we'll get to Bram Stoker's Dracula so we can really address it. But, and we did Devil's Advocate where he nails a Southern accent.
It is funny too, that a lot of people that were ruined, because then Channing Tatum was supposed to be Gambit and then that never happened either.
Yeah. Yeah, and so there's a, but we got this movie where they're doing the mutant cure, they're doing a version of the Dark Phoenix, and it's dumb and bad.
Yeah, I don't know where to start. So I guess let's start at the beginning, because let's just get this out of the way. This is the first movie to use de-aging technology, and it looks like the first movie to use de-aging technology.
No, a lot of the special effects in this movie are pretty decent. The Ken doll smooth Ian McKellen and Patrick Stewart are not it.
Yeah, it was funny too, because even one of the things I was reading was saying that they got old photos of them, or there's some, whatever the PR was for it was, you know, I read that supposedly they had this technology and they looked at what they looked like 20 years ago and they did. And I'm like, that's not what that looks like it did. It looks like you went into Photoshop and just smoothed out their faces.
I was like, Ian McKellen was never that smooth.
Because that's all they did. Their faces look exactly like their faces, except all of the wrinkles look airbrushed over. And yeah, it's so distracting.
They almost look like Daniel Von Bargen's replacement in the photo on Seinfeld.
Pretty much. No, it's so weird. It's to the point that it makes it when they do it with Robert Downey Jr., and his family later in the Marvel movies. I'm like, that looks so much better comparatively to this. And I hate that too. I hate all of it. It's never looked good. Nobody can do. And I, by the way, shout out to George Miller, because I did read that the entire reason that he put Anya Taylor-Joy into Furiosa instead of Charlize Theron, who he loves, is he was like, I looked out and I saw what the de-aging technology was like, and I thought it was distracting and bad, so I just cast a younger actor. And God bless him, he's right.
Yeah, he's right. It almost worked with Sam Jackson in Captain Marvel. That's probably been the best version.
Yes, that is the best version. I agree. But also because that's an unfair example, because Sam Jackson hasn't aged. So I don't even know that they did anything. They just told us they de-aged him. And we're like,
that's fair. Because that's true, because Clark Gregg did not look as good.
No. Well, and it's funny because Patrick Stewart hasn't really aged. Like 20 years ago, he looked pretty much like he did in the movie.
Yeah.
All you have to do is give him his Star Trek hair, like his horseshoe hair.
Just give him the horseshoe. Yeah. And then that would have been perfect.
Yeah. But it's bad. And then it's funny because, and we'll see how bogged down we get with this month. But so that's 20 years, which means that it's the 80s. And then somehow when they do the first class and that crew, they make it to the 80s. So at some point.
Because First Class is in the 60s, Days of Future Past is the 70s, Apocalypse is the 80s, and then Dark Phoenix is the 90s, and so, nobody ages.
So we have a real Ted and How I Met Your Mother situation where at some point, magically, he goes from, you know, being him to being Bob Saget. Like somehow he goes from McAvoy to Patrick Stewart, like, you know, in a day, pretty much.
It's sort of like Ewan McGregor when he did the Obi-Wan show, and then you know, in 6 years, that's how harsh the Tatooine desert is. It just ages you.
Yeah, another one that doubled down where they had 17 years or whatever to play with, and then we're like, no, let's do a show that takes place right in the middle of this timeline.
Not right before. Let's do it right in the middle.
I still think they should have done the baby's day off pitch that we
100% that we pitched in the very first episode. Yeah, it's
been so much fun
Ewan McGregor baby's day offing a baby Luke that just keeps like falling into Sarlacc pits and
right. That was
dens. And
if you haven't listened to all 200 episodes, the quick pitch was that It's just him on Tatooine, and baby Luke is constantly almost dying, and he's using the Force to save him, and that's what ages him.
Yeah.
Like, you see him aging in real time.
Well, and I still think the funniest pitch that I saw online was for a second season of Obi-Wan, where it fast forwards about 8 years, and you know, he decides to give Luke his father's lightsaber, and then they go on a quest to destroy the Death Star.
They should do that. Yeah.
Yeah. After his Luke's aunt and uncle get horrifically murdered.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
It sounds like where that story should have started.
Yeah, just where there's like this new hope for the whole galaxy.
Because it's like you watch Obi-Wan and you're like, I mean, this just feels like this is set up for a better story.
Yeah. There's something better right down the road. Anyways, X-Men The Last Stand. It's dumb and bad.
Juggernaut says, I'm Juggernaut, bitch, because Brett Ratner saw a meme.
Yep, that's the thing that happens. Mm-hmm. And I thought we were going to hold off on the silver linings.
Sorry, my apologies. Brett Ratner's a terrible person.
He's a bad person. Should we just start there? Right now.
Yeah, and Elliot Page has detailed that apparently Ratner said homophobic things and was terrible, and that's been backed up by, I believe, Anna Paquin.
Yeah, that Elliot Page was pre their transition and also in the closet sexually, like with their sexual identity, and Brett Ratner just outed them to the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and yeah,
and that's awful. Don't do that.
No, Brett Ratner is a bad person, and it sounds like a bad set. And it sounds like all of the X-Men up until this point had bad sets, because Singer also had bad sets, too. And that was a lot of why Halle Berry didn't want to come back, is because of, you know, her dealings with Singer and saying that he would show up inebriated and all sorts of fun things.
Yeah. Yeah. These movies were fraught, to say the least.
Yeah.
So that's out of the way. So the environment the movie was made in was dumb and bad. And while I think it counts as a silver lining, I'm going to use it to set up just a big reason this movie is maligned. What a fantastically misused cast this movie has.
Oh, for sure. And yeah, the pieces that they inherited are really great. I mean, obviously Hugh Jackman's Wolverine is the whole reason we're doing this month. Patrick Stewart is, like, he's talked about that when he saw the comics for Professor Xavier, he was like, who drew me in a comic?
Right. Like,
Ian McKellen is fantastic. Famke Janssen's great casting. Like,
Marsden's great.
I'm not going to relitigate our conversation with with Davenport. I'm not the biggest Cyclops fan, but
Marsden, no, neither am I. Cyclops is the worst.
But yeah, obviously we're big Marsden fans here, so always happy to see him.
Yeah, I love Marsden.
Who then dies off camera
immediately
10 minutes into this movie?
He has 4 minutes of screen time in this movie.
He's sad. He doesn't teach classes. Then he goes for a walk. He finds Jean Grey and she murders him off camera.
Yep. And they find out because they find his sunglasses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not good.
Because he was busy filming Superman Returns.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. But then just like the actors they added for this movie, Elliot Page, one who's always awesome. Big fan.
Yeah.
Vinnie Jones. Always love Vinnie Jones.
And yeah. Vinnie Jones. I do love that casting. Like, that's
it's perfect.
Yeah.
Someone who I think is one of the most underrated actors in Hollywood, Ben Foster as Angel. I love Ben Foster. I think he's great in everything he does.
And this is kind of an early.
This is pretty early. Yeah. This is pre like Hell or High Water and a few other movies that he's just phenomenal in. Shora Agadashlu, who is, plays the doctor that invents the cure. She's always amazing. It's just a phenomenal, like, Kelsey Grammer as Beast, probably the only one that's used to good effect in this movie.
Right. I mean, first of all, that's up there in the pantheon of like, yes, that's exactly who should play Beast. And I was reading that he was so psyched to play Beast that he auditioned for the role, which
was one of the first times he'd auditioned in decades. Yeah.
Yeah. And so God bless him. And obviously we're well documented fans of, you know, particularly the Rumble specifically.
Yeah, Money Plane is easily his pinnacle as an actor.
But this might be his second best role. Yeah. Not this movie.
Role. Yeah. this is his third appearance on the pod, too.
Oh, because he showed up in Nick Cage month, too, right?
Oh, fourth. Because he did the Christmas movie. The right, Christmases.
Wow. Yeah, we've done four. Yeah, four Kelsey Grammers. This is our second Marsden. I know.
Yeah, so, you know, kudos, friends of the, they count as friends of the show now, is what that means.
Mm-hmm. If we talk about you on multiple shows, you have to be our friends. That's
yep, that's how that works. That is in the bylaws.
And they all agreed to it, even if they knew it or not.
It's in the SLP bylaws. It's actually part of the most recent SAG contract, believe it or not.
Yeah.
More than four of your episodes.
We're really proud to get that in now. There. That was a big win for us.
Yeah. You know, it could have been one of the reasons that the strike took as long as it did.
No, a lot of actors hated it. They really fought pretty hard.
I was like, these fucking guys, come on.
what are we talking about?
What does friends mean? It's like, oh, they just have to say that you're friends. They're like, oh, that still feels like too much.
Yeah. And like, to be clear, we came down on that because we started with friends means if we need to go to LAX, they have to drive us. That was like where we started.
If we need to move a sofa there.
Yeah. Yeah. It was like sofa moving. Like if we need someone to house sit for us, like we started pretty high and we were talked down to, we get to say that they're friends. And if they're asked, they have to be like, it's true.
Yeah. And so far, no one has upheld their end of the bargain. So we should probably get back to the table on this. But
they're all in breach right now.
So, you know,
weirdly, they all say fuck those guys.
Every single one when they're asked.
It's very strange.
Yeah, it hurts. It hurts a lot. If I'm going to be perfectly honest,
you think you'd get numb to it, but I think it hurts more every time.
Yeah, it's almost like getting stabbed with a bunch of little quills.
Ooh, that's good.
To tie it back around to this dumbass movie. But no, like the cat, like, so you have Ben Foster does almost nothing in this movie. You have Elliot Page, who is in the movie. Mm-hmm.
Who they're almost setting up a love triangle, but then they're not even interested in that either.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Between Iceman, Rogue, and Shadow Cat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then you have Shura Agadashlu, who doesn't do much, but she's so great. She's such a great actress. Like, she just always brings, like, a really great gravitas to roles that she's in, even here. But, you know, it's like, still, she doesn't do anything.
Yeah, she gets two or three scenes, I think.
She gets killed by a hug.
Yes, that happens. Everyone in this movie that dies in a stupid way. I think we should just address that. Except probably Jean Grey, honestly.
Yeah, she gets Wolverined, and that's pretty cool.
And it's right. I will say, again, maybe this is an early silver lining, but as much as I don't feel like they were very interested in doing the Dark Phoenix plotline, I think something that is true of the original story and the spirit of that story that they got is that Jean has to decide to want to die to save everyone else because she becomes too powerful. And I think for what we had in the previous two movies, the like having Wolverine be the one to do it, I like that. I think that's a good choice. I thought in it, if the rest of the movie worked, that would have been a great ending.
Yes, but unfortunately, the rest of the movie does not work.
Unfortunately, you just want the movie to end at that point.
Yeah.
But I mean, look, it completely squanders a great cast. It squanders the goodwill of two previous movies that were beloved and that people really enjoyed. And it's not good. And Ratner's terrible. I think those are kind of the broad strokes. I don't know if we need to specifically malign anything else.
The one other special effect I want to crap on is Multiple Man. Man, that looks bad.
It does. And it's a shame because I wanted to like the idea of him because I thought it was a clever idea when the government is doing the raid and it's him.
That was neat.
I liked that idea, but then it doesn't, you're right. It doesn't look good.
But like when they first introduce him on the bus or the cargo prison cargo van, whatever, like it looks so bad.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
For no reason. Like there's which no is, reason it looked.
Which is weird because that one's an effect that we've had.
Right.
And not only have like we as society have been able to do doubles of someone for a long time. There's been so many movies where one actor has played twins or whatever, but also in the X-Men movies, because you have Mystique as a character
playing opposite them, like playing. Oh, Anthony Held is another actor that does like one thing. And Bill Duke does nothing and he's great.
Right. But yeah. But you know what I mean? You already have Mystique. So often in these movies, someone is face to face with themselves. Like that's constantly happening. So you would have thought they would have had that down.
Yeah, it's frustrating.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think those are the broad strokes.
I mean, like the idea of like there's like when Callisto is like, there's no one higher than a class two mutant here besides you. And then like the classes of mutants, like that was dumb.
Like, well, especially because no one's ever mentioned that until this movie. And who's coming up with the classes? Like that's right. For a franchise that does a pretty good job with exposition in general and with establishing things. And that's, I think, a real strength of if you watch, especially X2, because a lot of the exposition is out of the way from the first one. Things that are going to come back, you know, it's like Xavier freezes time on the school trip to show you that that's a thing he can do so that when they do it to the president, you already understand what's happening and how it works. Like there's a lot of organic storytelling in that. And then now this movie's like class two mutants, class five mutants, class mutants. And it's like literally these have all taken place in a school and no one has ever mentioned the rankings of mutants until this movie.
Right. And this is the first time they talked about like the non X-Men mutants and the non like Brotherhood of Evil mutants. And that could have been an interesting thing. Like, what about these people that just have, you know, like they can sprout quills and other dumb mutations that aren't like really good.
The kid with the blue tongue that's in X2. Yeah, that seems to have its only power.
He's got a forked tongue.
Yeah.
Yeah, so like
I also that was all bad. And this is about X2 and we don't have time to get into it here, but that is a big swing in that movie that it's like, I'm sorry, Charles Xavier does have the ability to put on a metal helmet and kill all of humanity with his brain. I do actually think we should all be doing something about that.
Yeah, that's something we should know about.
Yeah.
That's knowledge too we should much have. Power. Yeah, that's a little. He just has to sit in a planetarium and he can kill the whole world.
And look, if you're like, well, Charles Xavier's a good guy. Well, sure, I buy that. But also, it seems pretty easy to just trick him into doing it.
Yeah, it didn't take the most powerful, mentally gifted mutant in the world was duped pretty quick.
I will never kill all these people. Wait, a little girl wants me to? Okay.
All right, let me kill him.
Fine.
For you, sweetheart.
I can't. It's that face. Oh, let me pinch those cheeks while I kill all humanity. I'm going to do it.
Yeah. So
are we pivoting?
Before we pivot. Oh,
okay. All right.
Before we pivot, I think we're going to sit in the liminal space for just a second.
Okay.
Is that we know that Kevin Feige was a producer on this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Once Gene sort of gets unleashed on the world, a lot of people turn the dust. And I just feel like Feige's like, hey, write that down.
Yeah. What if this was good?
Let's put that back in the pocket. Let's put this in our back pocket for later.
Well, you know, it'd be good if when these people turned to dust, someone cared that it was happening.
What if we could make people care? What if it wasn't just anonymous henchmen turning to dust?
This, but emotional stakes. How about that? You know, it's funny that you say that because it is interesting with this movie in that I don't know. I guess this is liminal because I don't know that this is necessarily a silver lining. But you can see it, as we said before, you have these X-Men movies and the Spider-Man movies are sort of these proto-Marvel stuff that's showing, hey, you can make Marvel movies and they can be good. And Kevin Feige was involved in this, as you said. And also we open with the comic book pages flipping opening graphic on this. And then you get a Stan Lee cameo. So I think what's interesting about this one outside of the movie itself is you can actually mark that we're about to enter. It's still a few years before Iron Man comes out, but we're getting there. This is actually marks the transition from that previous, you know, like the early stages of good Marvel movies to this is showing you we are now entering the MCU era, and that's about to happen, and it's about to be much more consistently good than these movies are.
Yeah, no, 100%. Yeah.
So that's, yeah, like I said, probably liminal, but worth noting.
But yeah, I'm ready to full on pivot.
All right. It's an hour and 45 minutes.
Yeah, it clocks in just above our ideal hour 30, but below 2 hours, which is too long for a movie to do on this podcast.
Right. It still felt a little long because it's not great.
Yeah, it dragged in parts.
But I appreciate that it was under 2 hours. And so I will count that as a silver lining for this show. Always.
Yeah. Always. Legitimately good scene. And supposedly a sixth of the budget was devoted to this was Magneto moving the Brooklyn or the Golden Gate Bridge to Alcatraz. Like, that was cool.
It was.
And
cool.
That was a good scene. That was good action. It really worked. It felt like it created stakes, all the things you want out of a final scene.
I agree with all of that. Yeah.
So that was legitimately good. And that's it for like really cool action scenes.
Yeah. I mean, we said the cast is great. Because I feel like a lot of the cast kind of get like, I feel like you hear Patrick Stewart all the time. You hear Hugh Jackman all the time. You hear Ian McKellen all the time. And even like Kelsey Grammer was such a big. So I want to specifically just take a moment to say that in all of these movies, Famke Janssen, I think, is underrated in these movies.
Hugely underrated. Yeah, yeah, she's great.
Yeah, I don't think she gets the credit she deserves. I think she's really good. She's given. It's sad because I read that she was excited about the Dark Phoenix saga when she signed on, and she was
when she originally got cast as Jean Grey in the beginning. Yeah.
And she was unhappy with this, obviously, because why wouldn't she be? But even then, it doesn't quite work. But you can tell she's trying. I think she gives a good performance. I like seeing her, like she's great. She's great in this character. I think she nailed it.
Yeah, no, I think one of the reasons she's probably had, relative to most of the cast, the least success outside of the X-Men movies. But no, she's phenomenal as Jean Grey. And yeah, just in all three movies, I think she does really well.
I think it's time for a Famke Janissance. I think it's about time.
How long you had that in your pocket?
Just
Murphy?
Now. I swear to you, I just came up with it, but I am going to register the domain and get that hashtag going.
Hashtag Famke Janissance.
Yeah, it rolls.
I'm
off
here
the
for it.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. We had the McConnaissance. Let's have the Famke Janissance.
I think they should. I like those two together. You had your
McConnaissance, and now we have the Famke Janissance.
I've lost it's all okay. ability to talk, but yeah,
because you're so caught up thinking about the Famke Janissance.
Famke Janissance. There's still time when you're adding Ryan Reynolds. We know you're listening to this podcast. When you add that
friend
joke
of the show.
In, when yes, when you add that last minute Quinjet joke in, please also shoot a Famke Janssen cameo. There's time.
just a reaction shot, just like an eyebrow raise or something.
Yeah, you can shoot her out on green screen just to get her in there. Make her the new Stan Lee of Deadpool movies. She just shows up and waves.
She's just a hot dog vendor.
That'd be. I mean, it worked for Bruce Campbell, so.
Pizza Poppy.
Yeah, yeah. Be a vendor. It's great.
And Stan Lee was a hot dog vendor in the first X-Men.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
No,
was
like
he
this,
not in the second one? Or is he in the second one?
I'm sure he is. I just don't remember where.
I don't remember a minute. Yeah, he probably was.
But no, yeah, Famke Janssen, I think, deserves special mention. We talked about this before, but it's just a funny joke that Cyclops dying early is great, but losing Marsden is bad. So it's like a wash.
It really is. Yeah. And we got to see those beautiful eyes right before he went.
Yeah, those beautiful Marsden eyes.
A little marzipan candy man.
Oh, someone called him that and he immediately broke up with them.
Well, the person was Tina Fey.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, it's a fun bit of trivia, but the original comics X-Men are all in this movie, and it's the only time that that's happened.
Yeah.
That you have Jean Grey, Beast, Iceman, Cyclops, and Angel. Never in a scene together, but they're all in the movie.
And that feels like the amount of work that went into that.
Yeah.
For sure. But we put them all in the movie.
That feels like, oh, hey, we did that. All right.
Yeah.
I think Anna Paquin does a really good job in this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, love Anna Paquin. It took me getting used to with her playing Rogue, because I think Rogue should be like Blanche from the Golden Girls. Like, she always felt young to me in a way that was odd. But
they kind of made a choice to make Rogue more like Rogue in the movies is more like Jubilee in the TV series, the animated show.
100%. That's exactly what it is. Yeah.
And yeah. So yeah, that it is a little weird, but I think Anna Paquin's a good enough actress that it worked.
Yeah. No, I mean, I enjoy her in it for sure. I also like, again, this is from X2, so it doesn't count as a silver lining for this movie, but when Mystique and Magneto are mean girling her on the plane about her so white streak of hair. Yeah. There should be more scenes.
I love what you've done with your hair.
Yeah. Like, there should be, that was good. There should be more scenes where Ian McKellen is just mean girling people with Mystique.
God, I could watch them just roasting people. Well, even great. Like Magneto, Ian McKellen is cold blooded when Mystique takes the cure bullet for him. And he's like, you're not one of us anymore. And just leaves.
Was like, yeah, she's been down the whole time, man. That is cold. Like,
and then as he's walking, it's like, she used to be so beautiful. And it's like cold blooded like that. That's more villainous than any car he blew up.
Right. That's Tyra Banks. We were all rooting for you levels of just
it's catty as hell is what it is.
Also, we pivoted and I'm not because this is not a silver lining, but he moved his hands more in this one, right? Like, it seemed like Ratner really thought that he had to gesticulate a lot more to use his powers than I remember him doing in the previous two movies. Just noting that.
Yeah, it's just, this is a thing to note. But no, Ian McKellen is fabulous. He's great. Vinnie Jones is a great casting as Juggernaut.
And I loved when he knocked himself out. That was a good scene.
Yeah, that was a good example of like respecting the rules of the world.
Yes. No, it was well done. And it was a good moment for Kitty to get to do that as well. Like, you know, a clever way to beat him.
Yeah. I think we did it.
We did it. And it's perfect because it gives us a little bit of time. And there is something an update I want to give here at the end of the show. So this is great. So we're done with the X-Men part and we're going to change gears a little bit. Because I think this is important to everyone, and I think that this is just good to share, and I wanted to share it with everyone as soon as we could. But I'm gonna refresh everyone's memory first, and then we'll get into the update. So I just want everyone to kind of know, and you'll see. And Andy, I didn't prep you for this, but you'll get where this is going. Can I ask a palate cleanser before we pivot? Because I feel like we're having both of you here, and I don't know when I'm ever going to get the chance to ask both of you this question before, but it's something I've wondered, and Jane Fonda is in this movie. Do you think she watched wrestling with Ted Turner?
She had to.
Like, I don't know if you've ever had this, but I've tried to picture Ted Turner and Jane Fonda, like, in bed, you know, or like on their couch, just
turning on Nitro,
watching Monday Nitro together. Like, did that ever happen?
Like, was she in bed next to Ted Turner when he called up Vince and said, hey, Vince, I'm in the wrestling business?
Yeah. She was like, good job, honey. Yeah. Tell him.
I think she's a really cool lady.
I love Jane Fonda.
I think she's up for anything. So yeah. I think yes.
Okay, so that was from us with Jonathan Davenport from our Ruby Gilman Teenage Kraken episode. And we posed this question. I thought it was an important question. And so the update is they started airing Who Killed WCW on Vice. I was watching it with Molly and Molly stopped me to go like, whoa, no, did you see that? And it is in the episode. It is maybe 2 seconds of screen time. You see a shot with there's voiceover going over it, but it's Ted Turner and Jane Fonda they're live in an audience being interviewed by Mean Gene Okerlund. And it's 2 seconds. And Andy, you can attest, immediately sent it to you in Davenport when I saw it. Because it was like, so she was there. But I think that doesn't answer the question, though, right? Because all we know from what Vice presented was she attended one Nitro, but that's, we don't know the context. We don't have enough information. We don't know if she just showed up to, we don't even know what the interview was about. So we don't know if she just showed up for like a quick cameo and then was in the car 5 minutes later. So I had to dig deeper, and I really did a lot of investigating, and I think I have a pretty definitive answer for us. So first thing I did is I had to find out where that was from, right? So did some sleuthing, looked into it, found out it was a February 12th, 1994 episode of WCW Saturday Night. So then obviously I watched all of that episode of WCW Saturday Night, and I have a little bit more to share with you so we can kind of, well, you can parse through this together. So then this is one clip. This is the clip, the interview clip, in full context.
Well, it's great to see the fans in the stands here on WCW Saturday Night. And we've got a couple of very special people. Good friends of ours and, of course, of World Championship Wrestling, Jane Fonda. Jane, welcome to center stage. And, of course, our fearless leader, Ted Turner. Ted, it just seems to me like you take a look at these guys, they get bigger, they get better, and World Championship Wrestling just seems to keep on keeping on, bigger and better all the time, too.
Well, I've been involved with the wrestling business since we started televising it back in, I think, 73, and so it's a real pleasure for me to be really in it now.
Well, the growth is phenomenal, and we certainly appreciate your support. I can't tell you what an honor it is. These fans love you. We want to see more of you.
But again, not quite clear. She's engaged. Like, what do you think from that? Like, what are you getting?
I think that was maybe the only wrestling show she's ever attended.
Okay. All right. So now that was the segment. We got that. Let's take a look at her from the rest of that episode and see if we can get a sense of if she enjoyed it, like if she had a good time. And this is what I found.
And he's got the fans behind him here. No question about that. As Jane Fonda and Ted Turner watch on and enjoy the Patriot.
From Macon, Georgia, weighing 235.
Let's forget it, Tony. You confused me again.
Well, you're the brain.
No, it's WCW, but look at it, the lovely Jane Fonda. My mind just goes berserk.
I think she got into it.
So I think I'm going to stand by my claim that it's the only wrestling show she ever attended. She's like, how can things get better than the Patriot versus Steven Regal and Johnny B. Bad versus Ravishing Rick Rude? How could it ever get better? I don't want a chance, and I'm never going to another show.
Sure, but I think she became a Johnny B.
Bad. She had fun. Oh, she's a big Johnny B. Bad fan.
That was clear, because if you only heard the audio version in that last clip, she is animatedly cheering for Johnny
and hugging him. And
because he came up, he gives her a like he plants a cardboard kiss or whatever it is on her face, and then she seems into that, and then she's very excited during his match, and she is cheering for him.
Yes. So she had fun at the show.
I think she had fun at the show. And I think that again, was she a wrestling fan? That's a different question. That's not what we posed. But did she watch wrestling with Ted Turner? Yes. And I think Davenport was right. She's a fun lady who seemed game. She not only went, she had a good time. And I think we can.
Yeah, here's what I'll say. Here's what I'll say on that. I think that she probably never said, hey, Ted, put wrestling on.
No.
But she also probably never like told him to change the channel if he put wrestling on.
Right. Yeah. So I think we have a clearer picture. But look, we can I think we can stamp a yes on this case, but I think we can also leave it open to if further information.
So appears. Jane Fonda, if you're listening,
and we know that you are,
holler at your boys. Let us know. Were you a wrestling fan in the 90s?
Yeah, that's what we want to know. Also, by the way, fun fact about that episode of WCW Saturday Night. It was the debut of Terror Rising, the ill-fated Triple H character.
Shocking that that gimmick didn't get over.
I mean, it's so good. It's so good. His name is Terror Rising. Yeah. So there was that match. There were no reaction shots of Jane Fonda during that match. So we can't know how she felt about Paul Levesque.
No. Man, we did it.
But we did it. We definitely found the silver linings of X-Men: The Last Stand. But then we also solved the mystery. And I think that that's a good week as far as I'm concerned. I
can't think of a better week to have.
No. And I wouldn't want to think of a better week. How about that?
Silver Linings Playback is a production of HoboTrashCan.com. If you enjoyed the show, please rate or review it on Apple Podcasts. Hear more great shows on the Peak Sloth Podcast Network.